Scotty address it to move on, and I have.
What do you think is the biggest misconception about you?
Misconception? That I was forever a happy, smiley person, probably. Hmm. And in fact, there was a lot more going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how do you think you've most shocked people? I think that was an easy one.
Oh, that's easy, man. Aye, that's easy. Not only from that, but I'd probably say the blonde hair and comedy goatee was not a very good time in my life.
That was fairly shocking, but I'd probably say it's not your most shocking act.
Well, I was just coming from a haircut angle.
Haircuts are big in pop, I appreciate
really,
that.
Really, man.
Who would you most like to apologise to?
Well, I think that if you're lucky enough to be able to rebuild bridges, that's a great thing. And I think that if you can come to, if you can understand the word sorry or apologise, you know, because some people use that word, oh, I'm sorry, so many times in their life that it doesn't hold weight, and be able to use the word in its true context is a great thing.
Can you find it easy to say sorry and truly mean it?
Well, I think for a while that you can brandish that word, as I said, sorry, and it doesn't hold any weight. But when you use that word, make sure it's in the right context and you're meaning it, or else it just doesn't make sense. It's such a powerful word.
It's like love, isn't it? I love you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Very, very. And a lot of people use these words and don't use them with the right weight.
Especially songwriters.
Well, I think you should have a good amount. I think as a songwriter, and as a singer, you gotta believe it. If you believe your stuff, you believe it and you feel it, then other people can tap into that. That's a great thing.
What has been your most extravagant act?
Loads. I don't know. Getting the jet to go and pick up a takeaway or something. And, you know, when we're on the other side of the world or something. Hey, let's do that. It's not exactly peanut butter sandwiches, is it? But. No, I mean...
You did do that, didn't you?
Aye, we did. A lot of things like that happened, because it all makes sense at the time. You know, the sandwiches are all the wrong shape, all that kind of syndrome, you know.
Oh, you didn't do that?
Well, I mean, I can remember having an amazing rider all the time. You know, backstage, you know, you'd have all your champagne or whatever, and blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, we'd think, everything's got to get... We've got to cut this down. We need to get out. A lot of this stuff isn't getting used. And in our infinite wisdom, we get rid of the assorted cheeses from around the globe. Nice one. We don't need that. Need to ever eat the cheeses, lose the cheeses.
How many times did you send jets for takeaways?
Drop of a hat.
No.
Well, I think little strange things that you do are quirky, and it just made sense. And there was four of us into the kitty, so it wasn't that hard in the wallet.
So what would you send out for? What was the takeaway of choice?
Oh, Indian, by far. Indian, we loved Indian food.
Yeah.
I can remember phoning the guy up and asking him if he does a home delivery service. He said, oh yes. I says, well, can you take it to Glasgow Airport? And there'll be a jet there soon. Waiting there for the naan bread.
And where were you at the time?
Where was that? Well, Switzerland, I think we were. Switzerland. Try to get a good curry in Switzerland on a Sunday afternoon, it just doesn't work.
That's great.
Yeah, it was great. It's good.
But it tasted good.
And it was still hot. I've been around the world.
The tracks that you've performed for us, we've talked about some. You've been around the world, I mean, you certainly have, but I'm sure you're not talking about yourself here.
Well, that's an observation again, that's a wee character I made up. You know, Been Around the World was the only lyric that I wrote for the album. That was the only one I wrote, and it kind of tips its hat to this guy who, like myself, you know, has found himself in a position where he's had so much happening to him, and like it can be taken away. I guess another bite of the cherry, so to speak.
Mm.
So I mean, it starts off quite negative, but then, you know, there's a positive meaning to the end. And I'm glad the fax machine was broke that day, because it made me put pen to paper, and I think that's no bad thing.
What do you mean the fax machine was broken that day?
Well, that's what I would usually do. When I was in Memphis, I would just phone Chris up and say, hey, listen, I've got an idea for a song. Can you write me a song? It's about a guy that's in a bar, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, the smell of tobacco and perfume still rife in the air. But he doesn't want to go home. And that's about as much brief as I would give you about a scenario, or Chris. And he would say, yeah, okay, yeah, all right, I dig that concept. And I'd go to my bed, get up in the morning, fax machine would come out, and then there would be my lyric. I'd take the lyric, go and put music to it. And that's pretty much the way we worked.
Gosh, am I like fast food in some ways?
Well, I think that the concept's good, you know what I mean, and then you've got a good direction, then it's like, you know, we don't have to be in the same room. Okay, we wrote a lot of songs together in the same room, and I think that's why, we do have that relationship. Mm. Where I can be on the other side of the world and say, listen, I've got this tune, man, but any ideas going to be in your head or anything, or, hey, listen, I've got this thing about trailer trash, and I talked to this guy today and he told me about this, and that'll get him thinking, and he'll send me the lyric, and then I just fit it in.
So where did the concept from this, for this guy sat in a bar and he doesn't want to go home come from? Was that you, or was that an observation of somebody else?
No, it's just an image I had. You know what I mean? And it's happened to me, you know, I've been in a bar, you know how when everybody else wants to go home and you're thinking, I don't want the party to end. Hmm. You know, there was an element of that. And I think it's a good image.
Yeah, it's always nice to have something that you can visualise the song, a scenario. Mm.
A scenario, and that's very much, you know, we'll talk about things, you know, from a lyrical point of view, and that's it works. You know, fling an idea, or he'll bring something to the table, and I'll go, ah, it's a good concept.
What's the most difficult thing you've ever done? Something that's really challenged and taxed you?
Definitely my journey of sobriety. Definitely. I mean, that's, you know, that was by far a real, the best thing that I've ever had. And it was a real challenge to embrace that.
Must have been the best and the worst thing I've ever
done. It really was. Because I think as a being an addict, you're very much, your arrogance sits in, I've got it under control, everything's all right. No, that's okay, man, I can take care of this. But I think once you get knowledge, then you're all right, and you can move forward. That was the most challenging thing I've ever done.
Must have taught you a lot, though, about yourself and about kind of what's important.
Well, I mean, a few times I've been quite flippant on this interview, you know, talking about certain things, you know, be it materialistic things and stuff like that. Yeah, I have been quite flippant. But I think the humbling experience of being able to, you know, just open up and say, yeah, I needed help, you know, and embracing that and finding yourself in that position and being, and really wanting it. Not a very religious person, but it was very spiritual.
Yeah.
You know, it was a real, I still get lost for words for it. I'm not going to question it, it happened, and I'm going to, hopefully I can hold on to that. And getting a bit of serenity in my life.
Yeah, getting back to basics almost, I would imagine.
Painfully, aye, sometimes, aye.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, well, obviously, it has to be very painful.
Oh, absolutely, guys.
Is it something you've used on this album? Is it something that you've interpreted as a songwriter?
There is, in some cases, that it has tipped its way to that and got itself in some of the lyrics. But I think that's a good thing. Mm. And I think there's yet more to come out. You know, this is still early doors for me as a songwriter, as a solo songwriter, sorry. And I think it will come out as I grow.
So maybe you've not tapped into it fully yet?
No, I don't think I have. And maybe I will and maybe I won't, but I mean, it's definitely something that's very tangible to me, and you know, as strong as love as and strong as hate.
And this is an observation, and you tell me if I've got it right or wrong here. But you were always kind of thick as thieves, as you say, with Tommy.
Aye.
And he was kind of, you know, your partner in crime, but also your support system in many ways.
Yeah.
And now you have, you tell me if you have, a similar relationship with Chris Difford, who I know has had the same experience as you. He's had an addiction and a problem that he's overcome. So do you think that is kind of a...
Oh, well, there's a reference
point.
There's a reference point on it there. You know, there's a reference point that we do. And, I mean, it's good to be able to pass on knowledge.
Mm.
And he was a great inspiration to me. But first and foremost, he's my friend.
Yes.
You know, we're not two sick puppies together. You know, it's not that. I mean, we do share an enormous amount of time with each other. We work together. Yes, he is a friend, and a good friend, and a good friend's better than pocket money.
A good friend's better than pocket money?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Well, that's what, you know, for me, pocket money was always a blessing if you get some cash in your pocket, but you got a good friend, you don't need money. You'll look after you.
Did you ever wake up?
Oh, it's a Chris lyric. You know, it's a Chris lyric. And it's that, that's about being in a relationship, you know, and or finding yourself. Here's a good one night stands. You know, I've been watching television, and so many people said, you know what, I had this one night stand, and I woke up in the morning, I could have gnawed my arm off. What happened there? And you wish the person away. Mm. And that's what that lyric is, at face value. But there's some lyrics in there that are quite relevant to me. Did you ever wake up shaking? Or did you ever wake up reeling? And you know, so I mean, it's quite, you know, it can lean many different ways, but that's the beauty of his lyrics.
When you say shaking and reeling?
Shaking, man, you know, want a drink, or, you know, reeling, clucking, you know, that sort of thing. Just, I mean, it's what you want to take into, you know, it's what you want to bring to the table, and that's the beauty of a good lyric.
What do you want that you don't yet have?
I don't know, you know, I mean, everybody has dreams, you know, everybody has dreams, and to try and get and to achieve, you know, hopefully I will have all those things in my life, like being a father, like being, you know, and having a family, you know, hopefully that will unfold for me and make my life more full, you know, make my life more complete, the big picture that everybody else has. You know, I think that's as relevant for me to have that too.
Oh yeah.
You know, I think, and you know, and have, and be able to keep this this balance. I've got going. That I do have time for family, and I do have time for work, and be able to differentiate, and not let the pendulum swing to one side. And, you know, just keep a balance.
So, what would you most like to be remembered for? What do you hope that people kind of treasure about what you leave on this earth?
Being a good songwriter, a great singer, a good entertainer, and people who know me being a good listener. You know, as life unfolds, you know, God blesses me with children, being a good father, it's a whole bunch of stuff still to happen to Marti Pellow. Wanna get close to you.